Good evening and welcome to Talk of the Neighborhoods. I'm Joe Heisler, your host, coming to you from the BNN Live Studios, Eggleston Square, Jamaica Plain, where tonight on the Boston Neighborhood Network, well, we have a terrific show, all politics, as is our usual wont. Tonight, we start off with some election 2013 coverage, and what race better to watch? The mayor's race, that's right. We're continuing our profiles with candidates running for mayor. There's 24 that have pulled papers tonight. One of the early favorites to make the runoff in September, we're talking District 5 City Councilor Rob Consalvo joins us. Then on the second half, we'll turn our gaze towards the 1st Suffolk Senate District. That's right, there's a special election there to replace Jack Hart, who gave up his seat primary a couple of weeks ago. And next week is the special general election. Tonight, a debate with the Republican and Democratic candidates. All that and more tonight on Talk of the Neighborhoods. Stay tuned. We'll be right back. All right, we're back with Talk of the Neighborhoods. I'm Joe Heisler, your host. Tonight, a two-part show, but all politics, as is our usual wont. Tonight, first up, he was very quickly out of the gate after Mayor Menino announced he would not be running for re-election. Got lots of company since then. Of course, 24 different candidates have pulled papers to run for mayor. Tomorrow is, incidentally, the filing deadline, and so we'll see how many of those candidates show up with 3,000 certified signatures is what they need to get on the ballot. But I'm extremely pleased to have joining me tonight an old friend. He is currently the District 5 Boston City Councilor, served there for some 11 years, and looking to take a step up to the big chair. Rob Consalvo joins us. Robbie, nice to have you here, my
Thanks.
Friend.
Thanks
so
for
much
me.
For coming in. Well, and we got to talk campaign, but I got to ask you, before we start, did you have any inkling, you're a neighborhood guy?
Yeah.
Any inkling at all that Mayor Menino was about to step down? I know it's a bit of old news now.
Yeah, no, I had no idea. I didn't see it coming, quite frankly, thought he would run again. Planned on supporting him for re-election, and if he ran again, he would win. And in fact, just the day before, the newspaper called and asked me and said, do you think the mayor runs again? And I said, he absolutely will. He's as popular as he's ever been. He's got $1 million in the bank. There's no way he doesn't run. And then sure enough, it shows you how correct I was. A day later, he announced he wasn't running.
Well, he didn't call and tell Rob Consalvo. But did you talk to him, obviously, before you decided to run? I mean, you've always been tight. He's, as I said, you're a Hyde Park guy, a Reedville kid, You talked to him before you decided to throw your hat in the ring?
I did let him know. I absolutely called him and let him know that I was running and why I was running and what my plans were. And, you know, he's been a great friend to me for my 11 years on the city council. We've been a great team. And I got to say, honestly, one of the things I'll take away from this service in city government and public service as a councilor is the fact what an awesome team we had out in Hyde Park with Angelo Scascia, my mentor, Steve Murphy, our council president, and the mayor and I all working together for common interest out there. So he is a great friend. He was a great friend. He was very supportive of my efforts on the council, some of the number of initiatives I've done that I hope we can talk about. And so I did let him know, did ask his advice. He was as
what did he say? Did he offer to help?
No, he did not. No.
We can make some news here tonight, Rob.
He's staying out of the race, and I respect and understand that, and that's great that he chose to do that. But certainly offered a lot of great, kind words of advice. And certainly no better person to take advice from on a citywide run than a man who goes down in history as probably one of the best mayors to ever serve.
Well, there was a lot of people that have always thought that, you were his favorite. And as a matter of fact, the Herald expose at one point, will Rob Consalvo become council president? Little did they know, little did anyone know. Is that bothersome or was it flattering?
No. Those were rumors that I've dealt with since the first day I got elected. the mayor and I are great friends. Our families go way back in the neighborhood. I held signs for the mayor as a kid when he ran for city councilor. So certainly longtime family friends. But there were no truth to the rumors that any deal was cut. You know, I never became council president, much to the rumor mill that I was going to get handed off the mayor's thing. That was never discussed by us. We never talked about it. Yeah. And I would like, again, once for the record, as much as I love the mayor, he's not my godfather. My Uncle Joe was my godfather. And an important point that my mother, who loves the mayor as well, but my poor Uncle Joe, who loved being my godfather, used to say, I can't get any...
What's the story?
So anyway, that's a great story. And, you know, the mayor and I will remain friends. Yeah. He's a great guy.
Well, but fact of the matter remains, you're from the same neighborhood as the mayor, the only candidate, if I understand correctly, from District 5. Yeah. Does that mean you'll inherit his machine?
Well, we hope to get everybody, truthfully, and I know that sounds like a line, but you know what? I'm running an all-inclusive campaign. Obviously, we have many same friends, and a lot of them are helping me, and I welcome anybody who wants to help the race. So anyone who wants to join on board, I'd love to have them, whether they're from the mayor's team or anyone else's team. If there are people that don't qualify for the ballot, let's say, unfortunately, of the 24 people who pulled papers, if there are other candidates who, for whatever reason, don't get the signatures, I welcome them. I would love their support, and I would love the support of their team. This is an all-inclusive campaign, and it's what I've prided myself on as a city councilor.
And I know you've got people from all over the city. I just saw the prime sign location in the entire city of Boston, right at the gate of the tunnel from East Boston. I know you got some help over there, and from other neighborhoods as well. Because you have been so tight with the mayor, does that mean you have to kind of tread a little softly, though, now as you run for fear of stepping on his toes ruffling his feathers?
Look, I don't look at that at all. I mean, this is a race about my vision for the future of the city. This is me talking about why I'm the right candidate for three reasons. The strongest background, having worked in the United States Senate for Senator Kennedy, who was a mentor, working in the legislature for Rep Scotia, doing state bills and constituent services and public-led policy legislation, and now 11 years as I would argue the hardest working city council with the strongest record of real ideas, real ordinances, real public policy that are making a difference every day in the city. So for me, it's the trifecta of that experience that separates me from the pack. But also at the same time, it's about my vision moving forward. How do I use my experience and background? What is my vision, as you saw me outline in my campaign speech Thursday night? What are some of the ideas that my vision to move the city forward? And really also, who has the strongest commitment and proven record of public service and helping people? I haven't had other jobs. I'm not a lawyer that has a law degree to fall back on or held another position for another organization. I've been in public service my entire career. I've only had two bosses, well, really three, the people of District 5. Public service and helping people is a calling for me. That's why I'm all in this mayor's race. I'm giving my council seat up. I don't have another job. I'm unemployed if I lose in November and September. And I say that because...
I hope Michelle will kill you if you don't win.
Well, thank God I'm blessed to have a wonderful wife and family who's on board. The point, though, is I'm all in because I'm ready to make the 100% personal, political, and professional decision to be the next mayor of the city of Boston. And that means, too, the calling of public service, why I believe... we should be running for mayor, and that's the public service and helping people.
Doesn't with so many candidates in the race, though, doesn't it make it, including three of your colleagues, doesn't it make it tough to kind of differentiate yourself? How do you differentiate yourself from them?
Yeah, it's a great question. It's a great question. I think, one, the background, and why I think the background's important is, look, a mayor of a city like Boston, the capital city of Massachusetts and really New England, has to have the cachet to be able to walk the halls of Congress and fight sequester cuts that impact the city and walk the halls of HUD to fight for affordable housing and Section 8 subsidies and more funding for our public housing developments in the city. You got to be able to walk the halls of the state house to advocate to the legislature for state legislation. So the separation is there's no one else in the race that brings all that experience. Yeah, there's a state rep who has state experience, and there's folks that have a DA who has countywide experience and city experience. There's no one that's worked in the Congress that has state, federal, and city experience. So there's a differing point in terms of my record of public service. I'm very proud of my record on the council in terms of the initiatives and public policy matters that I've brought. Everybody talks about a strong mayor, weak council system as our charter, but the council's only as weak as it want to be, and I think we're a great council. And I've used my 11 years in the council to be a real leader in public policy. It was my initiative that brought ShotSpotter to the city of Boston, and through that acoustic gunshot technology, we're reducing gun violence, we're reducing response times in shootings, we're preserving ballistic evidence to make our court cases stronger when we prosecute criminals. Do you know that since we put ShotSpotter in effect in 2008, 30% of every police response for shots fired did not have a 911 call with it. It was only ShotSpotter that sent it to the scene of the crime. So it's being effective in terms of bridging the gap between people who are afraid to call 911 and getting police services. I authored the groundbreaking foreclosure law that holds banks accountable for their blighted properties in our city. No longer can they leave abandoned houses that they foreclosed on in our neighborhoods that become havens for drugs and gangs and overgrown grass and trash. That was our law that's been modeled all over the country. And I did John's law, a first-in-the-nation drunk driving law named Navy Ensign in memory of Navy Ensign John Elliott, who was killed by a drunk driver that had been arrested for drunk driving, bailed out of jail by a friend, went to the city's tow lot and got the car within the hour of their arrest, and drove drunk twice in the same night, killing Navy Ensign John Elliott. We have John's law now that impounds vehicles and drunk driving arrests for 12 hours. That family, the Elliott family, took John's law to the United States Congress. It passed our Congress and was signed by the president as now the law of the land.
Federal law.
Our first ordinance, and the Boston was the first city in the country to do it. So no one brings that record. You know, your resume counts, and there's an old saying that let my record speak for me. What will I do as mayor? My record speaks to the kind of public, and I could give you more, the public policy issues. And then there's the vision, and we can talk more about that.
Still, when you looked at the field, did it give you a little pause? I mean, you know, your colleagues are substantive, and of course, the other candidates are, well, there's probably 10, 12 candidates of, you know, these are not fly-by-night candidates. These are serious candidates, have some money, have some backing. Yeah.
They're great candidates.
May have a base. Give you a little pause there and is this, you know, if I jump in here, like I say, you don't have the job to fall back on.
You know, obviously we weighed all the factors, and I will agree with you. It's a terrific field of candidates. I'm friends with almost everybody, if not everyone in the race. I commend them for running. It's an opportunity for all of us. It's an opportunity for a real dialogue in the city on important issues. And quite frankly, the 24 candidates running for mayor, the 10 people running for my seat, all the at-large candidates running, is an incredible opportunity for the civic life of our city. So this is a great thing that's happening.
We're loving it.
Yeah,
you know?
So I don't fault any of those candidates for running. I welcome them in the debate. They can only make the debate better. And when I win, make me a stronger candidate in the final and a stronger mayor when I win in November, based on their ideas and their issues, because I'm not afraid to work with and take other people's ideas and best practices.
Well, for our viewers, walk us through it. Well, how does Rob Consalvo break through now?
Sure.
I know you're probably not going to be outworked because
I'm working very hard.
I've been watching you for many, many years how you operate. But take us through the scenario. How does that work? For instance, does the fact that Danny Connolly, who used to live in Hyde Park, now lives in West Roxbury, and there's quite a few candidates from Southwest Boston. Does that hurt you?
There's also five candidates from Dorchester.
Right? Yeah.
So there's a geography being played out similar to that all around the city.
Yeah, get me wrong.
Yeah,
but,
so I would say this.
Walk us through it. How does Rob... Rob Consalvo make the final, finish in the top two and go on?
So I think, one, I have a citywide run under my belt already. Ran at large 10 years ago for the city council, garnering almost 30,000 votes citywide, just missing potentially getting a seat by 62 votes. I've kept those relationships for 11 years of friends who are supporters around the city, people like Anthony Petroselli, who's helping me in East Boston.
Right, now as a state senator there.
We have a strong, loyal base of Hyde Park, Rosendale, Reedville, and Mattapan that I've been speaking to all the key community leaders, neighborhood leaders, and Crime Watch leaders who are supporting my candidacy. If you drive out our way, you'll see it's a sea of blue signs all over Hyde Park and Rosendale. We continue to work with our neighbors in Hyde Park, Rosendale, and Mattapan, who are helping us get the case out in other neighborhoods. And then we grow out of our base. Anthony Petroselli is doing a remarkable job coordinating East Boston downtown on the North End for me. He put up 60 or 75 signs this weekend for me at supporters who have agreed to support my candidacy for mayor, thanks to Anthony and our work in East Boston. We're growing in the North End. At my kickoff the other night, the president of the Fenway Civic Association, one of the largest groups in the Fenway, spoke as a speaker about my candidacy for mayor.
Incidentally, I understand it was an incredible crowd.
It was fantastic.
700 people at the Cedars of Lebanon.
That's right. That's right. So we have the president of the Bay Village Neighborhood Association on board. We're growing in neighborhoods where people wouldn't think we would grow. And so in a crowded field, when you've got a very strong and loyal base, plus this growth in the Bay Village and the South End and the Fenway and in East Boston and the North End, we have a plan in place to be able to get our vote out and be one of the two finalists to make the race. I'm also very proud of the fact that I represent a district that's minority majority, 70% people of color. And I'm very proud of the strong support I have in communities of color that are just not only in my base, but are growing beyond my base into other neighborhoods of the city. That makes me a candidate that's all-inclusive. I've been so as a city council, representing all people from Holy Name Rotary to Mattapan Square, from Reedville to Lana and Roslindale and the Longfellow Area Neighborhood Association around the Arboretum. So a proven strong record of being able to, both in physical geography and in terms of people who live in those neighborhoods, reach across all boundaries and lines to serve. And that also shows my growth.
Surprised so many of your colleagues, so many people have gotten into the race. Because there are some straw candidates,
there
yourself
are.
Included. And normally that scares some people out. Of course, we'll find out who, in fact, has the signatures and can on, get on the ballot, but could easily be 10, 12 candidates.
I feel
maybe,
at least, yeah.
Maybe more. Surprised at that?
You know, I wasn't. I knew that if the mayor retired, there would be a strong base of candidates that would come out and run. Obviously, there's only been three mayors since 1968, so it's an opportunity of a lifetime for folks to make this historic run. And I quite frankly welcome it. First of all, as I said earlier,
The more candidates, the better for Rob.
Politically, the more the better, yes. But no, but they're all great candidates, truthfully. I'm friends with all of them and respect all of them immensely. And I think all of them running is a smart move for them, and it's great for the civic life of the city, and it gets us an opportunity to debate the issues. And, you know, there's going to be a lot of good ideas that come from a lot of candidates, not just me. I know that. My colleagues in this race have a lot of good ideas, and we'll agree on many issues even when we disagree on some or have different approaches on how we get to where we want to go. And at the end of the day, if I'm one of the two finalists, and when I win, if I am when I win in November, I hope to embrace their ideas. This is one of the things that I've been most passionate about as a city councilor. ShotSpotter and John's Law and the foreclosure ordinance, the new ordinance we're doing now to help autistic families be served better by our 911 system, these are all ideas that have come from other people, other cities, and other colleagues. I want to harness the energy and best practices of what ideas people have. And so that's why I welcome them in this race to have this discussion about the ideas.
Well, and I think there'll be plenty of opportunities, and there certainly will be here. And again, we appreciate you coming on tonight. Rob Consalvo, of course, is running for mayor of the city of Boston. Of course, the mayor, and I'm not sure if he embraced it initially or not, but came to be known as the urban mechanic, so to speak, for his attention to detail,
absolutely,
attention to city services. I know that's something you've always prided yourself on as well. How would Mayor Rob Consalvo be seen? What shall we, how would you like to be seen?
I'd like to be seen as the guy who's most committed to public service and is, like Mayor Menino, is the candidate and the mayor who's going to put others before himself. And a full-time committed mayor servicing all our neighborhoods, understanding that our neighborhoods are the lifeblood of our city and that city government is on the front line of helping people and making a difference in the lives of others. Whether you're investing in a park or a playground or helping a family, student and a family become the first to go to college, investing in the public schools, working collaboratively and cooperatively to improve our schools, not attacking our teachers and attacking our unions, the same kind of rancor that we see in Washington, D.C. that paralyzes that city, shouldn't paralyze this city, but being a voice to work with the school department on issues and getting real reform based on a real dialogue.
Well, Menino's had his troubles with unions, not to disagree with you, but...
I have two kids in the Boston Public Schools and a third that will join next year. So as mayor, I'll be shepherding three children through the very same system that I'm going to lead. So I'm not just going to talk the talk. I'm going to walk the walk to make sure that I'm the one at the table helping to get real reform and real changes and really working to improve on the successes of the schools. The Boston Public Schools have a great story to tell. And we need to replicate what we're doing right, but make the real decisions to change what we need to do to move the schools forward. So this is the passion of service and public service and city government. I hope to be, back to your question, to be remembered as or to be known as the mayor who continues the legacy of Mayor Menino, was able to take the baton of the great successes that has made this city great and has the energy and the desire and the love of serving in city government to move Boston into that next generation of greatness. We are a great city because of the mayor. The next mayor needs to be able to have the same kind of work ethic and determination to move the city even more forward. And that's the mayor that I'm going to be.
Well, you know, there's been some there's been a lot of talk about, you know, there has been for years about the new Boston, about the changing demographics of the city, and that perhaps, you know, this year or whenever, person of color will be elected mayor. Does that How does that work for you in terms of, does that make it tougher for you, a nice young Italian-American?
A quarter Irish.
Yeah, a quarter Irish. I knew you had some of that somewhere in there, but how much will that be a factor?
Look, I'm going to make my case to all the voters of the city, no matter who they are, where they live, what their color is, what their economic background, regardless of sexual orientation. I have a great story to tell about my service in government, starting with Senator Kennedy, the champion for so many people and a mentor who taught me so much, all the way to the great work I've done on the council. So for me, I'm going to be making my case to everyone. And by the way, I've run unopposed five times in a district that's 70% people of color. I'm very proud of the fact that people in my district, regardless of race, color, or creed, have thought I've been the guy for the job because we work with everybody. We serve everyone. My office and my team and myself, I've been a full-time city council with no other income, no other job. I'm not a lawyer. I'm a full-time city councilor who is working every day across all barriers to serve the people in my district. And I take great pride. Although we welcomed an opponent, and I love telling my story, not having an opponent for five terms, I think, speaks volumes to the kind of work I do in a district that's minority-majority.
Again, Rob Consalvo currently is the District 5 Boston City Councilor, looking to move up tonight, joining us here on Talk of the Neighborhoods as we continue our coverage of election 2013. Tomorrow is the deadline for filing signatures, and we should have a better handle on how many people are actually joining. Rob, you're all set. I'm guessing many thousand.
I have over 9,000 signatures in. I haven't been certified yet, so I'm waiting patiently. Yeah. I'm hopeful that the 9,000 gets me 3,000.
Well, and
I'm confident there's no doubt that it will. With a great organization of people on the street getting them. They're out even tonight just to be safe. We feel we'll hit the 10,000 mark for tomorrow. And 10,000 should be more than enough to get on the ballot.
And how that works is you can only count a signature once for a candidate. Did you beat the rush on special election day? And
we were right there with everybody. Our guy was right in line. And I've even dropped off a whole couple of batches myself. But I love getting the signatures. I was out at the Stop and Shop on American Legion Highway getting signatures just yesterday. I had a couple hours between events. Yeah. Instead of sitting at home, I figured I'd go right back out and meet some more voters. And it was a great opportunity because not only are you getting the signatures, but you're learning about issues.
And are you getting, what kind of response are you getting?
Phenomenal. Absolutely. Yeah. And that's in my wheelhouse, obviously. But, you know, we turn in signatures from East Boston, you know, the North End, every neighborhood of the city. We had crews out on election day of the special election that you're next guests were
right,
a part of.
April 28th.
We had every poll covered with people getting signatures. We had every poll dressed with signs, two and three signs at every single polling place in the city. So we showed the citywide strength and organization
on
election day.
And we'll see it roll out. Rob, as always,
thank you.
Nice to have you here. Best of luck.
Thank
we
you.
Hope you'll come back as we get into the season more. We're going to be doing a whole series with candidates running for mayor. Again, Rob Consalvo running for mayor of the city of Boston. Certainly the most exciting political development in the city for, well, some would say 20 years, as Mayor Menino announced that he will not be running for re-election. Rob Consalvo, one of 24 to poll papers, and will be on the ballot tomorrow. When we come back with more of Talk to the Neighbors, we'll shift gears, but not by much. Joining us, the two candidates left standing in the race for the first Suffolk Senate seat. Tonight, a debate forum with Republican Joe Urenek and Democrat Representative Linda Dorsena Forrey. All right, we're back with more of Talking the Neighborhoods, and in this half, a real treat tonight, a debate forum. That's right, of course, we're talking earlier about the mayor's race, but there's been a special election going on, especially parts of the city, South Boston, Dorchester, Hyde Park, Mattapan. It's a special election for the Suffolk, first Suffolk Senate seat. That's the seat that was given up by Jack Hart, who resigned, very spirited primary a couple weeks back. Now the special general election scheduled for 1 week and 1 day from today in that district. And joining us tonight, I'm pleased to have with me the Republican candidate Joe Urenek and the Democratic candidate Representative Linda Dorsena Forrey for a little debate forum. And nothing better, not a better exercise of democracy than that. So welcome both of you.
Thank you.
For coming,
Thank you,
Linda.
Thank you for having me, Joe.
Thank you, Joe.
Nice to have you here.
Thank you.
All right, why don't we start off with this? And please, you know, if you would, you know, stay away from the platitudes, but just so people have a better kind of feel for you, tell us something about yourself that most people don't realize about you, yet that really helps to define you.
Would you like me to start, Joe?
Sure. Why don't you start?
Okay, so a brief biography is probably in order. I'm a Dorchester native, born in 1951. So I have memories of the area during the 50s and 60s and 70s that I think some people don't who are younger. So age has something of benefit there to see how the area has changed over the years. And I've been involved in politics and political activity going back to the 70s, where I was very involved in the, there was some discussion and interest in doing something with the Dorchester District Court. There was a judge there named Jerome Troy that many people were upset about. So we had a campaign to change some of the goings on at the court. And I've been sort of involved in politics and activity ever since then in various ways. My mom still lives in Dorchester. She lives in an area called Meeting House Hill, which is near Barry Street and Quincy Street. So she's she's 95 now in good health, but we've seen the area change a lot over the years. And some of it, of course, is very positive and some of it is very negative. And so my interest in getting involved in the Senate race is because I'm very interested in the plight of families, particularly men and fathers in our city and in our state. And I think that the Senate has been doing a lot, the legislature has been doing a lot in the wrong direction, quite frankly, since the 1970s. And I think it's incumbent upon people who are in the legislature to really take a new direction if we're going to look at some of the problems that we're facing in the city.
And that's what made you decide to run?
That's right, yep.
Representative Forrey, tell us something about yourself that most people don't realize, but yet defines you in a way that, I'm sure that is attractive to people and makes them want to vote for you.
Okay. Well, I would say first, I'm happy to be here with you, Joe and Joe, really to be able to have this discussion and this debate, and a good forum, really, to be able to talk about the issues. I say for myself, Joe, I grew up next to Quincy Street, so I grew up in Upham's Corner. Mm-hmm. My parents still live in Howard Avenue, where I grew up. For me, I came into the public sector because I watched my parents, how they were able to buy a two-family home. Two-family Victorian. They came here, immigrated here from Haiti, and they really worked on helping other families who did not have relatives here on their own. And so when our relatives left the house, you know, the first floor apartment was vacant, and so my parents opened it up and let other Haitian families come in and live there for free. And so as I'm a state rep now, sitting here, I've been a state rep for 18 years, but really been in the public sector for close to 17 years, you know, I always go back, right, and never forget where I've come from, but really realized that it was since I was a child. I saw it in my house in terms of how it's important to reach back and help those who need assistance so they're able to get on their feet mm-hmm. and really to be able to provide for themselves and their families. I mean, you know, I'm a mom, a wife, I'm a mother of four, and families are critical. Right? I mean, I think I live in this incredible city. We all live in this incredible city. And one other thing, we're both Dorchester natives, right? Born and raised in Dorchester. And I think there are incredible opportunities here in Boston, but we have to make it better.
It's okay. So, and we're not looking necessarily to criticize, but no. Help us to differentiate. How is it that, Joe, that, you know, you're different than Linda, and what would you bring to the table that's different? What would they get if they elect you that's different than if they elect her?
Well, let me just say, I think on a personal level, I think that Linda was married and has a very stable, from all appearances, a very stable and happy family. But I think some of the policies and laws that she supports, I frankly am quite opposed to.
Such as?
Well, such as the domestic abuse law. I think the domestic abuse law has been a disaster since it was first came into effect in the late 70s. I think about the time you were born, Linda, perhaps, it came into effect. And it came into effect under the assumption, the mistaken assumption, that women were always victims and men were always batterers. And it's a very sexist and discriminatory law. We go into the courts, I go into the courts, and I help men and fathers all the time. And we see people being separated from their families, from their children, being thrown out of their homes, because someone makes an allegation against them. There's no due process involved here. It's just an allegation where people are removed from their families, and all the consequences, the legal, emotional, and financial consequences that occur from that. So I think that on a personal level, Linda has a great family, but on a political and ideological level, I think she's completely wrong.
So, women's rights, men's rights in some ways.
Well, equality and due process are really not men or women's rights. It's something that's a human right for everyone. And I think, unfortunately, we're seeing the ramifications of an ideological program that started 30 or 40 years ago, and it's been very destructive, I think. And the legislature, in my opinion, has been very derelict in its duty for not recognizing how damaging these laws are. I don't think many legislatures actually know the effects of their laws. The domestic abuse law and domestic violence, so-called domestic violence laws, has actually turned into much of an industry. I think today there was a Senate budget that came out where they're going to give $1 million or $2 million to programs for these so-called domestic violence programs. But it really is a very destructive law, and it's very destructive to families.
Linda, is that you agree, and is that the only difference? How do you differentiate yourself from Joe Urenek?
I mean, first, I want to congratulate Joe in terms of putting yourself out there, because obviously running for, you know, running for office takes a lot of political, it takes courage to do that. I have to say there's a lot of issues that I've been fighting for, that I care about, that I'm sure you care about, that you may not be aware in terms of small businesses. I've been a champion for small business issues, but bringing it back to families. I am a champion of families and children and parents. And I filed an amendment this past session, or actually this session, that deals with attorneys at litem, who really deal and become the voice of that child, to really do more in terms of domestic violence training and domestic abuse training, so they're able to see the signs of, kind of to the extent of what you're talking about, in terms of which parent would this child really be better fit in terms of being with. But I would say for myself, you know, there are a lot of issues that I care about, and I look forward to having the discussion with you. You know, from small business is critical. We want to be able to provide access and opportunities to our families, to the mothers and fathers in our community, so they could have a good paying job, to be able to keep a roof over their head and put food on the table. So economic opportunity, job creation is critical. The other piece is about public education. I mean, we know that education is it in terms of moving people out of poverty, moving people to self-sufficiency. Yes, we have some good public schools here in the city of Boston, but we could do more. And that's something I support and I've been fighting for, to make sure that every school is a quality school. But, you know, there is a lot, you know, that we need to deal with this session. I mean, infrastructure is critical and transportation is critical. It's about access, making sure people have a way to get to the employment that they need to get to the jobs. And I just have to say one final piece, it's about connecting communities. And to be the state senator, and we know we have one more election on May 28th, we have an amazing trail, the Neponset Trail, in our communities from South Boston, Dorchester, Mattapan, and Hyde Park. And I want to be able to fight to make sure that we can connect these neighborhoods and make sure that we can have the conversation.
Let me respond a little bit. You started off by talking about attorneys ad litem. I believe it's actually Gotti ad litem that you're referring to. Frankly, we see that, and I see that as really a very destructive process in the courts. The courts should take a presumption that both parents should share parenting time. Now, the guardian ad litems and the lawyers, they use that as a battleground to actually break up families. And so the legislature should be actually trying to take guardian ad litems and the courts out of the family business as much as possible. And I think to go down the road that you're talking about is really the wrong course, respectfully. It really
Who would you have control that process then, Joe?
Well, I think the court should take the stance that unless there's some reason why a parent is not considered to be fit to be a parent, then the courts should have no business deciding who should be a parent, because what it comes down to is a battle over the financial resources of a family, and both parents lose, and ultimately the children lose in that process. We see this all the time, where it's not the best interest of the children at heart here in the court system, it's really the best interest of the lawyers and the people like the guardian ad litem, who you know, are lawyers oftentimes and get a lot of financial benefits from being in that system.
Well, let me inject because I know you can respond to that, but because it brings up some interesting things, you know, here in the race, and I want to ask you about it as a woman of color. How important is that, and has that become an issue in this race? You know, there's no history in the first Suffolk district of re-electing someone of color, or a woman for that matter. And how important is that? And Joe, I want you to come in after that, but okay. I want to give Linda first.
Sure.
I think I would say for me, the most important part is the experience piece. I am an experienced legislator. I've been in the public sector for 15 years, actually for 17 years. I've worked in city and state government. So really being able to connect the dots and bring real results to the neighborhood and our communities is critical. And I think that being able to make it to victory in the first round on April 30th, it was about reaching through different communities, reaching ethnically, culturally, economically. That is the community I represent now. I've been a state rep for 8 years, representing Dorchester, Mattapan, High Park, and Milton, a city suburban district. But I think, you know, this is a time where, you know, folks are coming out on May 28th, you know, to make a decision. And I think if you're coming out to vote, and we need you to come out and vote, because there are two separate elections. People are a little bit confused that there's an election on May 28th. Yeah, and we want them to know to please come out. But I'm asking people for their support, because I have the experience in really bringing people to the table to build coalitions and build partnerships. And I think it's important to also bring people that don't agree on stuff, right? So Joy and I may not agree on a situation or what have you, but it's important to be at the table, because that's how we have sound public policy.
Joe, does that, majority of the people in this district are people of color, and there's since, does history or the lack of history work against a candidate like you?
Well, I think the idea that we have a majority-minority sort of slogan out there is a little bit superfluous. I mean, it's really, there is, as you say, a majority of people who are of color. But I think that we're past we should be past the race and gender stereotypes. We should be looking at the policies that people are putting forward. And quite frankly, Linda and I are on really opposite sides of a lot of the policies and ideology. Now, Linda, for example, supported changing one of the bills that she sponsored or supported recently was something called the initiative petition. She wanted to, along with Cynthia Cream and some other representatives and senators, change the initiative petition process so that only initiative petitions that did not affect what was called the rights and liberties of the citizens, according to the Constitution, according to current law, they would not be allowed, any initiative petition. That, in effect, would gut the direct democracy of the people of the state. And so I think on those kinds of issues, we're really on opposite sides of the fence here. Direct democracy, the ability, when the legislature is recalcitrant and not responding to the will of the people, then the people should have a right of initiative petition to change the laws directly. And a bill that Linda supported like that, I think, is a really bad law. So it's not so much what race a person is, what gender a person is, it's the policies that person is bringing forward. And I think you're looking at policies that will benefit the district. I think the policies that I propose will bring power back to the people instead of leaving it in the legislature, which I think has been very petrified in a lot of ways in terms of responding to the needs of the people.
I will just say this, that, you know, to be able to do this work every day in and out, to attend community meetings and to listen to the issues and the constituents that call with real concerns of losing their home in foreclosure, and being able to stand there with them and fight to get their house back to them is critical. And that's the work I've been doing, making sure that kids and families who are being displaced have a place to lay their head, making sure that our small businesses in the Commonwealth, you know, and this is where we differ, obviously, because we're Republican and Democrat, but I believe in the democratic value. We live in an amazing, amazing country where, yes, we're from different, you know, ideologies and, you know, we come from different point of views, but I can tell you, I fight every day for our small businesses here in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, have been a champion in making sure that we can remove the barriers for them to be successful in terms of regulations and policies that have crippled our small businesses here in the state. And I've been proud to be the chair of small business since 2009 in terms of leading the change around health care for small businesses and other issues.
Well, let me jump in here because, and I want to play a little devil's advocate here.
Sure.
I'm sorry, but Linda, help those voters. And I'm going to start with her. And
sure.
I'm come back
go ahead.
To you, if that's all right. Help those voters that want to think, let's say Linda Dorsena Forrey, why are you not just another kind of tax and spend liberal? Or are you? But what would you say to those voters that may not line up, you know, just exactly with you philosophically? How do you convince them that you're not just another tax and spend liberal, a follower instead of a leader?
Okay, I will say that, you know, since April 30th, I've been, and before that, I've been traveling all over the district. I've been in South Boston, in Dorchester, Mattapan, in Hyde Park, and especially in areas that do not have me now as their state rep. And folks who know me and know my work, they know I am not just a spending kind of person, right? I think it's important to have accountability. I think it's important to have benchmarks and to have metrics in place when we're looking at, you know, different budgets that we're putting in place. But I think it's also important to think about the future. I think it's important that we invest in infrastructure and transportation. You know, we cannot be a high, you know, we cannot be a state of the art, you know, amazing city and state.
Even if it means raising taxes.
I mean, we have to invest in our infrastructure. No doubt about it. That's education. That's our roads and our bridges. We have bridges and roads in Massachusetts that are in dire condition. We do not have any more federal funds coming to us, so we have to raise revenue. You know, and I believe in raising revenue, not just to raise revenue, but there has to be a place where it's going. We need to raise revenue, which will then create jobs in terms of the construction jobs that are going to take place and making sure that people in our communities and our neighborhoods get employment and are hired. That is the right thing to do. If you're looking at the whole system, where is it that we need to invest? Invest takes money. And it's really interesting when you hear people talk about, you know, raising revenue, what do you mean by that? Well, that's our firefighters. You know, when your house is on fire, the fireman is coming and the firewoman is coming to put out that fire. That's the public dollars we're talking about. It's our police officers. It's the education system in terms of our teachers. It is all those different things that we take for granted, you know, because we live in this amazing country. We take for granted. It's our trash pickup that would not get done if we did not raise revenue.
All right.
And I think it's important that,
so
you know,
you're not opposed to raising taxes if it goes to...
No, I am not opposed to that. Okay. It is, yeah.
All right. Now,
well, I don't think...
And you'll have a chance to rebut them. But help our viewers who say, oh, it's, you know, a Republican, another Republican, a Tea Party Republican, a protest candidate, help those people who to understand
where I'm coming from,
where you're coming from, and is that how, or are you a Tea Party Republican?
Well, I don't think slogans and labels are very helpful, but let me just say that in terms, there is the idea that Republicans are the party of the wealthy, and certainly there are Republicans in the state who are wealthy, and there are a lot of Republicans, grassroots Republicans, who are just ordinary working class folks. I mean, just look in terms of the campaign that we just had, the Democratic primary, there was tens of thousands of dollars that were spent in the Democratic primary. Personally, I think that money would have been better spent going to feed some homeless people, you know, people that are hungry. To spend it on a political campaign, I find somewhat distressing. I mean, I believe maybe $250,000 was spent on the Democratic primary. On the Republican primary, hardly anything was spent, obviously, because there was no competition and we just don't have those kind of resources. But the idea that Republicans are all the party of the wealthy is just not true. Getting back to the idea that of raising taxes and spending, Of course, government has a role to provide basic services, helping the elderly, helping the children. But what we see in government now is a government that is, in my opinion, almost out of control, where they have the power to really tax and spend at will, especially in Massachusetts, where it's a one-party state. Now, when I was growing up, the Soviet Union was the one-party state that we all sort of argued against. Well, we have a one-party state here in Massachusetts. Now, in all fairness, there are other states, like Texas, which is also a one-party state, but it's all Republicans down there. A one-party system, no matter whether it's a Democrat or a Republican, is bad for the citizens. And so I would say to the voters out there that if you want to have innovation, if you want to have new ideas, then help take that one-party system down and think about casting a vote for me on May 28th.
Okay, we've got about 2 minutes left, and by agreement, Linda, look into that camera and give your best final pitch to the voters out there.
Well, first, again, I am happy to be here, Joe and Joe, to be here with all of you. But I want to turn to you now to ask for your support and your vote on May 28th. This is a quick election. It's in 8 days. And I am someone who has the experience, the legislative experience, but really the public service experience. I've been in this sector for 17 years, working on issues that are important to you and your family. It's job creation, it's economic opportunity, it's about strengthening our education system, but it's also about public safety and making sure that our streets and our homes are safe. And that goes from domestic violence to gun violence and to substance abuse. So we have a lot of work to do ahead, but I want you to know that I've been working with people hand in hand, folks that don't agree with me, and that's okay. But we work collaboratively in building a new partnership for this city, and I look forward to being your next senator, only with your vote on May 28th. Thank you.
All right, that's Linda Dorsena Forrey, the Democrat, the Republican Joe Urenek. Look into that camera, give us your best shot, Joe.
Sure, thanks, Joe.
About a minute.
Thanks, Linda, and thanks, Joe, for coming here tonight. So, as I said, my name is Joe Urenek. I'm a Dorchester native, and I hope you'll consider casting a vote for me on May 28th. You've heard some ideas tonight coming from Linda and myself, and I think you can see that there's quite a difference in approach to what government should be doing out there. I certainly support the idea that government has a role in helping the elderly and the children. In a lot of ways, the government we have now is overreaching in many, many areas, particularly in areas of family life. We have families being broken up, which leads to all kinds of social pathologies. We need to have the government back off. We need to have the laws that have been in place now for 30 or 40 years, we need to have them repealed. That's what I'll try to do, and the result will be a much better community for all of us.
Okay, again, Joe Urenek, thanks for coming
in.
Thanks for having me, Joe.
Thanks so much for joining us here. You've been watching Talk of the Neighborhoods. We're here tonight and every Monday night at the same time. Until then, for the entire staff and crew here at BNN, thanks for watching. Have a pleasant evening. Good night.